Operation Confidence proudly presents America's Invisible Heroes Talk Radio Show. Tune in weekly on Sundays from 2 p.m. to 3:30 p.m. Pacific Time with your host, Consuelo Mackey, co-host, Air Force veteran Matt Davidson, announcers Taylor Marcella and Brooke Gadesi, U.S. Army veteran and entertainment segment host Charles Whitehead, U.S. Army veteran and strategies for hope segment host Dr. Kathy Cash, U.S. Army veteran and lifeline for women veterans segment host Martha Elena Varela, National Director of Faith Services, Chaplain, and Veterans in Recovery segment host Anthony Asimpora, and U.S. Air Force veteran and Incarcerated to Success segment host Kevin Lewandowski. For more information or to be a guest on our show, email info@operationconfidence.org. Operation Confidence, America's invisible hero, invisible hero.
Operation Confidence is a grassroots nonprofit. The organization's mission is to provide stable housing for veterans who have experienced homelessness, as well as providing a wide range of supportive services. To help accomplish our goal, a successful landowner has donated land for the project, a world-renowned architect has offered to design the houses, and construction classes from the local community colleges will take part in building the houses. Your support and donations are needed. To get involved, please visit our website at www.operationconfidence.org or email info@operationconfidence.com.
Hey, welcome everyone. And thank you for tuning in to America's Invisible Heroes, a show that is dedicated to our veterans and their families. Yes, I'm your host, Consuelo Mackey, Executive Director of a grassroots nonprofit organization called Operation Confidence. I'm not a veteran, but my heart goes out to our disabled American heroes, especially those who have experienced homelessness. The show has been created to provide a platform for our veterans to be able to share, and their families to be able to share their heartfelt stories, resources, and challenges. And now I'd like to just say something real quick that our heart goes out to everyone suffering in Israel. We were to have Dr. Wendy Childress on this morning, but ironically, her computer got hacked in, so the last minute she had to back out. But we just want to let everyone know that she was going to say a prayer, and we're very sorry, and we just got everybody's in prayer for our friends and for the country of Israel. Okay, let's see. American Talk Radio Show, Visible Heroes Talk Radio Show now has a new format. Each week, the show will highlight one of our co-hosts and their guests. If they have a guest to bring on, they're welcome for the guest to show to be able to give their presentation as well. I'm going to let our board member and announcer, Taylor Richardson, to take over from here. Take it away, Taylor.
You got it, Connie. We have U.S. Army Reserve veteran Charles Whitehead, who is a board member and host of entertainment and investigative reporting. And we have U.S. Army veteran Richard Cooke and his monthly segment, I Once Was Whole.
Okay. Let's say a little bit about Wendy, although she's had a sudden hiccup, yeah. At least introduce her because she's one of our co-hosts and we love her so much and we're so sorry her computer got hacked right here at the last minute. So Taylor, yeah. Give a presentation for me.
So Dr. Wendy Childress is a retired Army chaplain, a former associate pastor, and has worked in the nonprofit sector and education for over 15 years. Dr. Wendy is a life coach, founder of Living Life Completely, LLC, co-founder of 52 Love. It's an organization she and her daughter founded to empower, edify, encourage, educate, and connect African-American women, and founder of WC Ministries. What is in a name? Do you want me to continue that?
Yeah, this is what's going to be her presentation today.
Okay, what is in a name? William Shakespeare asked that question in his well-known play, Romeo and Juliet. Dr. Wendy asked the same question as it relates to living life completely. What is in that name? What does it mean? Dr. Wendy will lead us, or the intent was to lead us on this name as we dive into its meaning.
So, and she's yeah. retired chaplain. Did you read that part already?
Yeah, that was in the top part.
Okay. All right. So she'll be back next week, hopefully. And we're going to take it away. Charles, would you introduce Richard?
Absolutely. Today, we have Richard Cooke. Cooke. He's a... Cooks. Richard Cooks. Yeah. What did you have for breakfast? Did you cook? No, just kidding.
Oh, yeah. All right. Oh, we do.
All right. Richard served 33 years in the U.S. Army Special Forces Operations, 7 years with the VA hospital as security human resources background investor, and he was promoted to GS-11 Chief of Payroll. Former stroke survivor of 3 strokes, a major stroke February 2016, and a massive stroke causing the most brain damage, including aphasia, June 3rd, whenever that was. His third stroke was just after a massive stroke in the brain that affected his vision that made him visually impaired. The strokes in 1 year caused by a tumor in my heart, blocking the blood flow, is what Richard says. Richard has a fitness plan that includes eating healthy, especially keeping sodium and sugar at a healthy level and avoiding shellfish. Richard exercises at the gym, working the entire time to form a therapeutic plan. His weaknesses were on his left side that made him unable to walk. After intense therapy, he was able to rebuild his body, regenerating the brain to walk. And now on some days he walks 13 and a half miles and weightlifts 10 pounds to 15 pounds weight, and now is fully recovered. Richard has developed a stroke survivor's plan to show the truthful way to achieve independence recovery from the stroke, as he is both physically, mentally, cognitively, and speech, visually, and independence, you know, with all of that. He has recently developed a boot camp for stroke survivors program. The boot camp for stroke survivors is unique compared to regular boot camps. It's like what he did when he first joined the Army, to cover a healthy lifestyle, physical exercise, and mental exercise. All right.
We got a few pictures to show, Richard, right, Taylor?
Oh, yeah. Can I start first right now on something?
Sure. Go ahead.
Let me explain. This last Friday, the Doctors for Mental Health, because stroke survivors will go through many areas of mental health, my doctors here at the VA hospital did everything, asked me questions, or they have a test in those type of questions. And everything I did was 100%. They told me you don't have any cognitivity problems anymore. So you're mentally stable based on what you've gone through. So that's what they just told me this last Friday. But also on Friday, I had a tumor right here in my wrist. That's gone. So everything has happened in a positive way. So everything is gone.
Congratulations. We always
right
knew
now.
You've been on the show for a couple of years now. We never knew anything was really that wrong other than you telling us about it. But we're happy that the doctors have given you the okay. So it's exciting. And your exercise program is amazing too. All the things that you've done despite your stroke. You're going to tell us more about your new program in a minute, but we have some pictures we're going to show, huh, Taylor?
All right.
You can narrate through that for us, Richard.
Okay. What that is right there, I actually took on this event, which was known through the Golden Age Games as the 1500 meter power walk. Now that's technically 4 laps around the track, which is equal to 1 mile. But I did that, and that's me right there. And I took 4th place in this part of the event. So I end up with 4th place. I'm not looking for any medal or anything like that. I was just looking for the ability of being able to do that when the strokes in 2016 made me completely limp. I couldn't walk at all. Now I'm walking and be able to prove you can still overcome your strokes.
That's amazing.
Of course, I've been doing some skiing through the winter sports clinic, and I also skied downhill, and that's where they gave me that, of course, that's the what they call a bib to wear around your neck side, your torso side, as identifying you're a blind skier.
Mm-hmm.
And lack of a better word, ribbons that they've given me for what I was doing for the various types of events.
Right.
Now this is here. This was actually in Los Angeles. I was just starting to climb it. And you might have some others to show where I climbed all the way to the top.
Oh, hold up. I got a question for you on that one. Did you have to have your hat on to do that?
They let me know. Sometimes different locations will have you still wear a type of hat in case you fall and hit your head, but that place with me.
Oh, well, that hat wasn't going to help you at all, you know, so.
Mm-hmm. No helmet, but that was cute, though. And you went all the way to the top.
All the way to the top.
All right, good.
And this is where I've been surfing at different types of activities through the Veterans Hospital. And this is where I'm surfing.
Okay, wait a minute. Where are you at? Is that you in the red?
No,
the first one.
Did he have to wear a hat out there too? You know?
No, I don't want no hat.
The guy behind you wearing a hat in the water?
No, he's wearing a hat.
Yeah.
No, the guy behind you has one.
Yeah, the guy behind you has a hat. Yeah, that's what I'm like. Look at the, you know, I say, okay. We're swimming with hats on. Okay.
So what was the guy in behind you doing, Richard? Was he just another?
He is the therapist, and it's kind of to guide the surfboard.
Uh-huh.
But also there as also like a lifeguard in case I do fall in the water. And then that way he'll be able to give me. Reason why is I actually, no matter how long I was in the Army, I don't know how to swim. They tried to teach me.
Really?
Thinking. Okay, uh-huh. That was during the time in the Army. But still, I don't have the ability to be able to swim, especially when the strokes may be weak on my side. But that's why he's still there. He is the lifeguard in that effect in case I fall in the water and I can't swim back up.
So then who is the other guy?
That guy right there in front in the green is me.
Oh, okay.
He knew that was you. He just
I didn't know because that guy is really dark. You know, I said, then that.
It's summertime.
I thought you were saying that was you, like, you know, like your head is poked up. Okay.
No. You look Richard, okay. The guy with the cap on, he's on the board with you?
Say again?
Is he on the surfboard with you?
Yeah, he's guiding the surfboard.
Yeah.
Sometimes the currents have rip currents and they can go the different directions. So that's why he's kind of guided.
Okay, that's amazing. Next picture. Is that it?
Those are it because the other ones had phone numbers on it. So,
well, was it his number? So we need him to give his contact information anyway.
Was it 310 something?
Yeah. It's okay. Show those other pictures.
Those are it. Those are the ones that didn't have any.
No, I mean, show the ones with the number.
Is that phone number yours that's on the picture?
Well, Richard can keep talking and then I'll pull up those pictures.
The picture that's right there on the screen right now, that's called Leaves of a Scarecrow.
Oh, you mean behind you, your background.
This is up from the Creative Arts Festival here locally, but the VA has transferred it and sent it off to Washington, D.C. Veterans Hospital for them to do the final judging. And I won't know until sometime in the middle of December how I place. Okay, this is myself here going to be doing the recumbent bicycle. Now, the reason why is because I tried to get on the bicycle, which normally all people use. Mm-hmm. I couldn't do that because my left side was still tipped to the left side. So this was the recumbent. It's like a three-wheeler in that aspect.
Okay.
And this is here while I was winning one of the prizes for the creative art, I mean, for the Golden Age games in regards to trying to get the word. It's bocce, like that. So, of course, that's my wife's phone number right there. So, anyways, she'll get calls. Anyway, but that's my wife's number because she was taking the picture. Of course, me, visually impaired, I still got a fourth place for bocce.
That's wonderful.
But they also had us where it was bocce, but we had to be still blindfolded.
Mm. What is this one?
This one is for cornhole.
Oh, now, cornhole
that time was still fourth place. So that's where I was able to still get the ribbon for cornhole. Cornhole used to be known as beanbag toss.
Right, right. Mm-hmm. Now they call it the hole.
Yeah, cornhole.
Yeah.
I said, where's the corn?
Yeah.
This is me. This is me climbing all the way to the top on that rock mountain.
Mm-hmm.
I'm just a few inches away from the very top.
Right.
And then that was it.
That's it.
So that's a Mount Everest starter kit.
So what's coming now, up next? Tell us about
this picture back here. Is myself. It's called Leaves of a Scarecrow. And what that's going to be judged on in December is see how I did, but it is entered as visually impaired.
Mm-hmm.
So I'll go till what happens through the final.
That's amazing. Now tell us about your new program.
Well, the program is.
You have the banner for that?
Yeah, for stroke survivors. Okay, that's what I'm doing. So there are other stroke survivors I will still be helping locally. Before you know it, it'll probably go nationally. And some have asked me if I could do it virtually. And I said, I'll work on that where it could be virtual.
You have the banner?
Boot camp for stroke survivors. Not to be mistaken, like true boot camp that we all have gone through, because stroke survivors can't do that right away. But it's going to be able to entice them positively to be able to have them work on their abilities based on their situation from their stroke. So, for example, I was weak on my left side. They still have to join with their physical therapist what they need to do. But in addition to the physical therapist, I'm going to come back a few days later and still encourage them to do the same things what their physical therapist has showed them. But then at the same point, I'm going to try to get them to be able to do more so that way they can be able to be encouraged positively to be able to do more and not just lay back and say, oh, I can't do this. Now, a lot of stroke survivors go through that mental condition of giving up. I'm going to entice them, encourage them not to ever give up. Like myself, I didn't give up. I want to show them how not to give up.
That's right. That's wonderful. I'm trying to get your photo here, the banner one, sent over to Taylor, but it's not working. But anyway, we're real proud of you. And where's that going to be held?
Which one?
The new program.
Okay. Boot camp for stroke survivors. It will be held at different locations based on certain requests for myself locally. Okay, so I'm just going to start locally, but I am working on where it will be done virtually as well too. So other stroke survivors will still be able to do and learn from my teachings on how to still overcome their stroke. So the thing is, whatever their location is, like I got one person in South Carolina who asked me as well too, can you teach you virtually? So I said, yes, I want to teach you virtually. So that way they'll know. I'll even be able to have the various documents of the various areas of physical therapy to be able to show them what they need to do physically. And then, but of course, I'm not going to have them work in ways that's going to affect them negatively. I want to work with them to where they don't have any types of ways that limits them. So for example, if they're weak, on a given side from their stroke, and I'm going to ask them to bend their knee. But if they can't bend their knee, I'm not going to push that because that's going to hurt them. So the thing is, I'm going to do what they can to be able to bend their knee. So for example, also, if it's their given hand, if it's like the right hand, this is my right hand, if they're going to be able to move their fingers, good. If they can move their fingers better, then that's what I'm just going to try to work with, how far they can move their fingers. So that way, mine was on the left side. Now, this side would not work at all. My left side would not work. I think I lost you. Oh, there you go. That's boot camp for stroke survivors. So that way, I'm going to teach them how to be able to move their fingers. So that way, they learn different aspects, but what they can still do is be able to keep doing that more often until they get more physical therapy from the physical therapist. Now, I'm not going to take the physical therapist's place. I want them to still learn from the physical therapist like that, but I'm going to teach them how to do that continuously until they can start having the movements like I've gone through.
All right.
Give your phone number out. I see it on the flyer, but give it out anyway.
Okay, so my phone number is 424-901-9524. Again, 424-901-9524.
Mm-hmm. That sounds exciting.
Yeah, so what's going to happen as well, too, I've been talking with a few of the therapists at the VA hospital, and they told me to still get the VA to endorse it so I can start teaching it right here on their campus. So for example, here at West Los Angeles, I'll be soon in the future be able to teach boot camp for stroke survivors right here on the campus.
Wow.
All right.
That's amazing. We're so proud of you, Richard. We watched you come a long way.
Thank you. Also, I tell Lauren I will be submitting that photo right behind me, right there, for her auction. That way she can auction that off. But that's the first slide of the photo. I will have a few other slides known as photo one, photo two, photo three, things like that. So I'll have more availability.
And that donation goes where?
Operation Confidence.
There it is.
It is.
It will go to the DAV because I now the current post commander for Disabled American Veterans right here in Culver City.
You know, that's right. Good deal. Well, long as you know what we're doing, which I know you're aware of. And of course, it was thank God for Lauren being one of our co-hosts that we made sure you guys were introduced and put in her auction. So I appreciate you offering to give a donation.
Well, if I do win at the national level, I won't know until December. Mm-hmm. If I do win, then I'm going to have that where it gets auctioned off at a higher price.
Okay, good. All right. Well, thank you. That's exciting.
All right. Thank you very much.
So we're going to move on down with the program for today. Okay, so we have a lot to talk about here. Taylor, you going to take it away?
Yes, I am. So I'm going to share the shocking story about an anonymous parent whose disabled child was left inside the school buildings during a fire. As a wheelchair user, I have learned across the nation, schools are placing physically disabled students in rescue rooms instead of being evacuated. Physically disabled students who attend schools with more than one floor are not evacuated during fires. This anonymous parent said, "This is unacceptable practice and was not aware that this is the policy at their child's school." As the parent, she as an able-bodied individual never paused her to consider that she needed to ask the school to takes full responsibility for that. It never crossed their mind that her child would be taken to a rescue room rather than have an adult help her exit the building. The high school her daughter attends is a two-story building. Like most schools, the only way for anyone who uses a wheelchair or mobility device or anyone who physically cannot do stairs is to use the one and only elevator in the building, and we all know you cannot use elevators during a fire. Last week, her daughter, who was a sophomore, was taken to a classroom during a fire drill while all other students were evacuated from the building. When she asked the adult why they were in this classroom and not going outside, the adult said, "So the fire marshals can find us in case of a fire. This is where they come to look." Interesting. Her daughter did the only thing she could think about at the time. She sent her mother a Marco Polo message and her face clearly showing her depression over the situation. Once home, she said to her mother that the statement translated to, this is where fire and rescue retrieve your body and the body of your fellow disabled classmates if they don't get to us in time. That is just terrible. The mother said her heart breaks again and again every time she thinks about the darkness her daughter had to settle with, the fact that she could not get out of the building. Someone decided her life was not worth prioritizing because of how her body works, and all she could do was hope for the best as she waits for a fire marshal to rescue her in time. This is not okay. So she emailed the principal and asked for an emergency meeting. They were fortunate that the principal takes all concerns extremely seriously. He contacted all the powers that be and arranged for a meeting the following day. The meeting including myself, the principal, a fire marshal, a police officer who works at the school as a first responder, the building's manager, the person who oversees safety and policy in all the buildings in the school district, her daughter's case manager, and the head custodian. It was a full house. And they were all there to make a new plan for a daughter who will be evacuated from the building when having another fire drill or fire. Also, I want to point out that while the American United Spinal Association was mentioned as a resource for making the plan led by disabled activists, their recommendations is to have all first floor classes so physically disabled students can easily exit the building.
That's right.
Isn't that the most horrible thing you ever heard?
It is. I can remember, like, and you don't realize that buildings, you know, aren't accessible until you're in this kind of a situation.
Right. But even yeah,
that's
though
a violation of federal law under the American Disabilities Act.
Yeah,
they're individuals will find ways to go around that law.
They come up with all these officials. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. It's like all you have to do is just make it accessible. That's it. If you have a child, if you have any students enrolled in your school with a physical limitation, that should be first priority.
Exactly.
That should be ground floor. You know, if they have to, you know, designate one class and a person got to be in that class all day, then, you know.
Right.
It's one class. Right. It's not the end of the world. It doesn't disrupt learning.
Right. You know, even though they want to go and be like the rest, but, you know, hey.
But I mean, like, hey.
Safety comes first.
It's true.
Like, bring some people from upstairs to downstairs. The able make it that way. You can't. No. Schools are making it to where there's that division.
Yeah. Some places, you know, for instance, like Rancho, they have 2 and 3 floors. For sure, they, they have on the second floor, they have a ramp that goes around like the side of the building. So it literally goes down to the ground, you know, the first floor. Mm-hmm. And that's in the old buildings, but in the new building, but they are attached, so they have ways, but some places just don't have it like that.
No. Yeah. And you imagine a unified school district?
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, you're not supposed to take the elevator, you know, so when a fire happens, you don't want to be in the elevator, you know, you're stuck on the second floor, like put everybody on the bottom floor if you can.
Exactly.
If you know it, yeah.
And easy access to the door, you know, mm-hmm. It don't happen where they have to go several miles on the first floor to get to the door either, you know?
Mm-hmm.
That's
so
horrible. I thought that was a good piece of information.
Yes.
That's amazing. We need to have more information on that so people will know who to contact. You know, did we have, was that in the piece on who they should contact at all, do you think? If not, we'll come back with it for sure.
They have to find from their local school district. Also, how it should comply with the American Disabilities Act under federal law.
No, I understand the local school district who was in the meeting, but they need to go higher up, the Americans with Disabilities Act. The schools made those horrible rules. Yeah. Everybody made a decision on that little girl's life.
Where was this at anyway? Do we know?
It's in another state, I believe. We don't want to mention the state because I don't want them to say that we're putting it out there. But
the truth is the truth. I think it is, but I think across the country, every state, there's a child who's experienced it. Every family has experienced it.
Exactly.
This highlights that,
just the fact that it's happening, in one school, let alone several. Okay, right. So let's move right along. Charles, you are investigative reporter. You got a lot to talk about. Do you have the video copy of that, Taylor? Just in case his computer has a glitch.
You attached it to the script. Is it that one?
Yeah.
Okay, I have it. I can pull it up.
Because I don't have it. I'm not showing any videos. Is this the same from, this is not the same from last week, right?
No.
Mm-hmm. Okay. All right. Well, anyway, we got this 79-year-old veteran who was forced out of his home. He says he was denied benefits to stay in VA housing. A disabled veteran who investigators said was beaten and robbed may soon be out of a place to stay. Grace White first reported the story back in March, and since then, three people have been arrested. The caretaker told a news reporter that he received a letter saying Veterans Affairs denied him the benefits he needs to stay at a VA home where he's been staying since he was forced out of his house by a scam. "I'm worried he doesn't have any place to go," said one of his friends. She was the one who first called police and Adult Protective Services about what was happening to her elderly veteran friend. Since the story has been reported, three people have been arrested and are accused of moving into the elderly veteran's house, beating him and stealing his money and cars. A letter to the VA said he does not require nursing home care, unquote, unquote, does not require nursing home care. Mm-hmm. However, the friend said living in on his own is what put him at the risk last time. It should be no question about him being there. He is not okay to take care of himself, she said. Turns out, the real suspect was his brother who was using his identity. The lead investigator in the case said everyone knew the third suspect by the fake name, further complicating matters. His brother is basically doing all sorts of crimes around the county and presenting his ID to the police so he could get away with the crimes, said the sheriff's office. The brother they were looking for turned out to be in jail already. Okay, investigators said the brother was arrested in one of the elderly veteran's stolen cars. Wow. Okay, I mean that's crazy.
Wow.
And it doesn't seem far fetched because I hear a lot of crazy stuff that goes on with people who have their elderly parents sign off the house and
right.
I know too many things. I know people who've done that, they go and they get their parents sign up to me and then I'll make sure and they go and get
take care of you and put you in a home.
Yeah, so, they take money out of the house and then it's like the parents are like, "Hey, I'm old, I don't know what's going on." And they tell them anything. And it's unfortunate.
It's horrible. So Taylor, show that video, please. People need to see this. I'm so glad we got an investigative reporter on the team here.
A disabled veteran who investigators say was beaten and robbed may soon be out of a place to stay. Our Grace White first reported on Roma Witten's story back in March. She joins us now in the newsroom with the update, Grace.
Today we called just to check on how Roma Witten was doing. His caretaker told us she received this letter today saying the VA is denying him the benefits he needs to stay at a VA home. That's where he's been since he was forced out of his house by a scam we first reported on earlier this year.
I'm worried. I don't have any place for him to go.
Patty Hallis is the friend who first called police and Adult Protective Services about what was happening to Roma Joe Witten. We first met him in March.
The car that was purchased, did you buy this car?
No.
And since KHU 11 News aired the 79-year-old story, three people have been arrested, accused of moving into his house, beating him, and stealing his money.
I stole everything.
But now he has a new problem. Hallis says she got a call and a copy of this letter saying he may not be able to stay any longer at the VA.
Extremely disappointed in what the VA has done to him.
The letter says he, quote, does not require nursing home care. But Hallis says living on his own is what put him at risk last time.
It should be no questions about him being there. He is not okay to take care of himself.
It's a scam that went even farther than the Harris County Sheriff's Office first realized. They charged three people in Witten's case, Holly Coleman, Summer Hampton, and a man that was innocent. Turns out the real suspect was his brother, using his ID, and the lead investigator on the case tells me everyone knew him by the fake name, making it even more complicated.
His brother is basically doing all sorts of crime around Harris County and presenting his ID to the police so that he could get away with the crimes.
The brother they were actually looking for ended up already being in the Harris County Jail. Investigators say Mohibola Malik was arrested in one of Mr. Witten's stolen cars.
During that arrest, he presented the deputies with his brother's identification, trying to conceal the stolen vehicle.
His charges have now been upgraded to aggravated robbery and aggravated kidnapping. Reminders for Hallis why it's important for Witten to be at a place that can protect him.
The community is what got him in trouble. We're going to wind up in the same spot we're in now in 3 to 6 months.
Late today, we contacted the Department of Veterans Affairs. A spokesman told us they can't comment on an individual case without a privacy waiver, but said they will do everything in their power to help veterans and their families. We'll let you know when we get an update.
Transgender.
Okay. So, thank you so much, Charles, for that bit of information. We have to let our viewers and listeners know what's going on out here.
Absolutely.
This is what a show is all about, you know?
Mm-hmm.
So look like we're going to end kind of early today.
I got a little clip, you know, since it's not on my computer, I have the link.
Okay, cool.
Show you that I might have showed this one a while back, but it's the one with the dog, you know, and the owners, you know, telling him about, you know, he's hungry, but he's making him agonize a little bit.
Oh, I love that. Okay. You can show it?
Yes, because it's not on my computer. So let me see here. Boom. Make sure I got it up. Yep. Okay. Here. Let me do the shares.
Oh, yeah. That's just cute.
Food. You know, I just couldn't stop thinking about it.
Yeah.
So, yeah. So, you know, I went to the fridge, and I opened up the meat drawer. You know what the meat drawer is, right?
Yeah. What was in there?
Well, I'll tell you what was in there. You know that bacon that's like maple? It's got maple flavor.
The maple kind, yeah.
Yeah, so...
Yeah?
I took that out, and I thought...
Yeah?
I know who would like that. Me! So I ate it.
Oh! No. You're kidding me.
Nope. Not kidding. You know, I also noticed there was some beef in there. Yeah, you know, steak, you know, juicy. Well, I ate that, too. But I went back to the fridge just a few minutes ago, and I put something together really special. You're going to love this one. I took some chicken.
Yeah.
I put some cheese on it, and I covered it with...
Covered it with what?
I covered it with cat treats.
Yeah.
Then guess what?
What?
I gave it to the cat.
Food. You know, I just couldn't stop thinking about it.
Only you. You're going to come up with something crazy like that. I love those little clips, though. That is so cute. Okay, well, Taylor, it's on you, my girl.
Before Miss Connie closes the show, I would like to encourage our viewers and listeners to visit the Operation Confidence resource page on our website at www.operationconfidence.org. Again, www.operationconfidence.org for some amazing resources. Also, we would like to inform everyone about Operation Confidence Positive Redirection Team. It's a group of male and female veterans who are mentors, having overcome similar challenges and situations, transitioning back into mainstream society. To be connected or become a team member, email us at info@operationconfidence.org. Again, info@operationconfidence.org.
Okay, and as always, we want to remind our viewers and our listeners that the goal for the show is to raise awareness about Operation Confidence and its mission, which is to provide stable housing with a wide range of supportive services for our veterans, especially those who have experienced a disability and homelessness. So please get involved with our grassroots efforts by contacting us at info@operationconfidence.org or send us an email. I'm sorry, info is the email and the website. Visit our website, www.operationconfidence.org. Once again, send us an email at info@operationconfidence.org or visit our website at www.operationconfidence.org. You can leave us a message there as well. Okay, so, and we're proud to let everyone know that America the Visible Heroes is moving right along here. We haven't been out for a couple of years, but we now have over 163,000 views on our YouTube channel, as well as a couple of 1.36K subscriptions to up to date. So we thank you so much, and we look forward to having you to continue supporting our show. And lastly, in closing, Operation Confidence, American Invisible Heroes, is also viewed on streaming on Spotify, Apple, Google Podcasts, as well as Amazon, iHeart, Stitcher. We have our own Instagram, and we also have our own Operation Confidence blog. So we're getting the word out. We want to thank all of you, and we'll be back for sure next week, God willing, and keep us in your prayers. Also, the precious, precious people in Israel. That's so sad. Thank you, guys. So we're going to sign off now. And you
thank you very much.
You have the ending video. There we go. Hey, Richard, we're so thankful and proud of you, my friend. Keep up the good work. And we want to
thank you very much.
What's going to be going on next time? You live an exciting life, and we're so proud of you. And want you, of course, to bring us up to date on what's next, okay?
Thank you very much.
All right.
Ready.
Bye-bye, everyone.
Bye now.